Hello Topaz, today we will be discussing one of the most interesting topic, that is edema. And in this video we will be discussing the clinical aspects of edema, like how to examine in OPDs or IPD, or regarding the gradings of edema, regarding the pathophysiology in a very very simplified way, not in detail, and then different types of edema and its causes. So let's get started. So this is how the normal feet will be appearing. So here in this normal feet, you can address the capillaries crossing here. So in this capillary, we can see two arrow marks here and here. So here they are, this arrow mark is mentioning that the fluid from the vascular compartment is moving towards the interstitium, and here fluid from the interstitium is moving inside the vascular bed. This is the normal thing which is happening in the normal body, like this is because of one of the pressure, that is hydrostatic pressure, and this is because of oncotic pressure. We will be discussing in detail regarding these different types of pressure in the pathophysiology part. So this is the thing which is normally happening. So whenever there is any imbalance in the hydrostatic pressure and oncotic pressure, that will lead to the swollen part or swollen feet. And here you can see that there is increase in the fluid moving from the vascular compartment to the interstitium, but there is only less retraction of fluid from the interstitium to the vascular compartment, and this is leading to the swollen feet, which you can address in the image. So this is nothing but a collection of fluid in the body interstitium from the intravascular compartment. This is the basic mechanism, basic imbalance in these two pressures, which is leading to the edema. So now we know what is edema. So let's see how to examine edema. So in case of OPD or IPD, if you are thinking the patient, if you will be going for general examination, that time you will be examining the patient for edema. So everyone knows about it. So first, let's see the procedure in exact. So first we have to examine legs for any swelling. First we have to check for it. Then how we will check? Even if we are looking at, we will not be getting whether the patient is having edema or not. So we have to apply pressure for few seconds. It may last from 50 seconds or maximally to 30 seconds. And this should be done in a very sequential way. So if we are guessing the patient is having edema in the lower limb, first we have to apply pressure over the medial malleolus, then on the lower end of tibia, mainly on the medial side. So wherever there is bony prominences, there we can give the pressure, and the upper part of shin bone by the tip of right thumb, mainly bony prominences, that you have to remember. So we have to examine in the sequential way from above downwards. Then we can inspect and palpate whether there is any dimple or pitting to find out the edema. So we have to repeat the same procedure on the opposite leg. So okay, we now know how to examine in a sequential way in case of lower extremities. So if there is upper extremity involvement, how we have to do? We have to start from the wrist, then lateral epicondyle of elbow, then we have to go for sternum, and finally forehead. This is the procedure to examine the edema. Then examining the back. So whenever a patient is presenting with pedal edema, like edema in the feet, we have to think, we should examine the back. So how we can do that? First, we have to put the patient in a prone position and press the tip of right thumb over the sacrum. And sacral edema is found mainly in the patient who is confined to the bed. Like in case of ambulatory patients, we can find the sacral edema. But this is more important even if the patient is in a normal normal day-to-day life, we have to examine the sacrum, and this is more important. So let's see the other areas which has to be examined in a patient who is having edema. First is genitalia, then trunk, then upper extremity, then over sternum, then over the vertebras, and then forehead. These are all the parts we should not left alone while examining. Then regarding the grading of edema, so first grade it is below the ankles, then the second grade it is below the knees. You can see the image, then you can remember it very easily. Then grade 3, it is edema of thighs. And grade 4, it is generalized edema. So let's see how it occurs. Okay. This is one of the most important thing. Even in the first image, we had a first slide itself, we had discussed little bit. So you can see the capillary bed here. So here it is arterial end and here it is venous end. So in case of arterial end, hydrostatic pressure will be working to pull out the fluid from the vascular bed to the interstitial area. And here the oncotic pressure, which is making the fluid retracted into the vascular bed. This oncotic pressure is mainly because of the albumin present in the blood. So this oncotic pressure is mainly exerted by the proteins in the blood. So simple, whenever there is any problem in the hydrostatic pressure, there will be a formation of edema. And whenever there is any problem with the oncotic pressure, like even in the case where there is lack of protein or whatever the reason which is leading to the lack of proteins, that will also lead to the problem in the oncotic pressure. Then like this is the first one, hydrostatic pressure leading to the problem. Then the second culprit is oncotic pressure, which is because of the proteins present in the blood. And third, it is the receiving part, that is our lymphatic obstruction. Like whenever there is any problem in the lymphatics, that will also lead to the edema formation. So these are all the three major things which are contributing for the formation of edema. And this is a simple pathophysiology we should know before getting in detail with the edema. So as I had already mentioned, here it is given that the problem or edema is mainly because of increase in the hydrostatic pressure, the number one culprit, then decrease in the oncotic pressure, that is the number two culprit, which is mainly because of the albumin present in the blood, then the obstruction of veins or lymphatic flow, that is the third culprit, and the fourth culprit they are mentioning is the vascular wall injury. If there is any problem with the mechanical or thermal or chemical problem in the vascular wall, that will also lead to the edema. These are all the four culprits which is mainly causing this edema, and these are the four major mechanisms behind this. So I think now you people might be very clear regarding the different causations. So let's see the different types of edema. First is based on the nature of pitting. So pitting edema and non-pitting edema, and based on the distribution, it is generalized edema and localized edema. So let's start with pitting. So pitting edema, it is nothing but the subcutaneous edema. That is, there will be increased interstitial fluid. So let's see what are all the conditions where we can see pitting edema. That is congestive cardiac failure. And even congestive cardiac failure has its own pathophysiology. Like if in case of right heart failure, we will be having different pathophysiology. And in case of left heart failure, there will be fluid collection in the lung. That is different. So cirrhosis of liver, here we can see the problem with the portal hypertension, which is leading to the edema. Then nephrotic syndrome. Here we can see because of the lot of protein loss, that will lead to the edema. And everything, like every condition has its own different pathophysiology. But those four mechanisms which we had already discussed, that will be the major factor behind all these things. And then hypoproteinemia with severe anemia, then pericardial effusion, then constrictive pericarditis, then because of drugs and because of venous obstruction. Yes, we know whenever there is any venous obstruction, that will lead to the issue. Then beriberi, then in case of wet beriberi, we can see this edema. Then epidemic dropsy, which is one of the adulterated thing which we had studied in PSM point of view. Then comes the second type, that is non-pitting edema or solid edema. So simple, whatever we know, like whenever there is edema, it is just because of the fluid. But here this non-pitting edema is indicating that it is because of the protein deposition, the edema became non-pitting. So there are few conditions which are having non-pitting edema. So let's see. First is mixed edema. So what is happening here? It is nothing but it is an infiltrative edema due to the deposition of mucinous material. Then comes lymphatic edema in later stage. Mainly we can see this type of edema in filariasis where there won't be any pitting. This is because of the protein rich fluid. Then scleroderma. So it is one of the connective tissue disorder. It is a self-limiting painless edematous induration of face, scalp, neck, trunk and upper extremities. We can see tightness of the skin also in case of scleroderma, and it has its own peculiar features like crest syndrome also. Then according to the distribution, first let us start with the generalized edema, which is popularly known as anasarca or dropsy. So, congestive cardiac failure, then cirrhosis of liver, nephrotic syndrome and hypoproteinemia with severe anemia. In these four conditions, we can see generalized dropsy, and a few other conditions are there, but this is the more major things which we can expect generalized edema with. Then comes localized edema. So, first cause of localized edema is venous obstruction. So, let's see the conditions where we will be getting the venous obstruction. First is pregnancy, as it is a Mengert syndrome, like I think it is that if a woman is lying in a supine position, the abdomen like uterus will be pressing over the venous return and that will obstruct. Then SVC syndrome, then IVC syndrome, varicose veins, then prolonged recumbency, then deep vein thrombosis, immobilized or paralyzed limb. Then comes second cause, that is lymphatic obstruction. There the conditions are first one filariasis, then tuberculosis, trauma, carcinoma breast, following radical mastectomy, radiation injury which is leading to the obliteration of lymphatics. Then Milroy's disease, it is one of the congenital condition where we can see the hypoplasia of lymph vessels, and it is one of the benign disorder, and we can see it is mainly affecting the young girls. Then allergic causation, other than venous and lymphatic obstruction, we can see this allergic cause. First one is angioneurotic edema, as there will be swelling in the subcutaneous tissue because of the destruction of mast cells, and it is because of the absence of C1 esterase inhibitor, which we can compare with urticaria. Then comes acute anaphylaxis. Then few inflammatory causes had been discussed here. One is insect bite, then snake bite, then trauma, then ischemia or infections, vasculitis, severe septicemia, then probably due to the liberation of histamines, which will lead to the increased capillary permeability. Then comes some related terminologies like slow pitting and fast pitting edema. So how we can find out this slow pitting and fast pitting, what it is mean? It's like if it is more than 40 seconds, then it is slow pitting, which we can see mainly in congestive cardiac failure. And fast pitting, it is less than 40 seconds, where we can see in the hypoproteinemia, that is nephrotic syndrome. It is just an arbitrary terminology. And thank you so much.